Good morning, Dr. Satish.
Good morning, sir.
I'll, in brief, in a minute's time, introduce you to this August gathering, sir, if you permit me.
Sir.
Thank you. Bhai aur behno, Dr. Satish Jain, Jaipur se hai. 1999 mein aapne MS kiya ENT mein, SMS Medical College se. Aur uske baad, Tata Hospital, और बॉम्बे के डॉक्टर देसाई हॉस्पिटल में ट्रेनिंग प्राप्त की. डॉक्टर कल्याणकर ने जब मुझे डॉक्टर सतीश जैन का बायोडाटा पढ़ने के लिए दिया तो पढ़ने के बाद एक चीज मुझे नजर आई कि व्यक्ति पुरुषार्थ से कुछ प्राप्त करता है और प्रारब्ध से उसे कुछ प्राप्त होता है. पुरुषार्थ आप हम सभी करते हैं, प्रारब्ध जिसे हम कहते हैं गॉड गिफ्ट, वो ईश्वर देता है. डॉक्टर सतीश जैन में इन दोनों चीजों का बहुत सुंदर मिश्रण है. वो एक राष्ट्रीय और अंतर्राष्ट्रीय ख्याति के आज गिफ्टेड सर्जन है. अगर मैं कहूं तो अतिशयोक्ति नहीं होगी. आज जयपुर में उनका एएनटी हॉस्पिटल भारत के प्राइवेट क्षेत्र में सबसे बड़ा और सबसे अल्ट्रा मॉडर्न हॉस्पिटल है, जहां मुझे बताया गया है कि 6 टेबल्स साइमल्टेनियसली एक साथ ऑपरेशन के लिए काम में लाई जाती है. अद्भुत क्षमता और विलक्षण प्रतिभा के धनी हैं डॉक्टर सतीश जैन, जिनके क्रेडिट पर, जिनके नाम पर 15 वर्षों के पीरियड में 70,000 ऑपरेशंस हैं. सर्जरी में अपनी विशिष्ट और नायाब शैली और कौशल्य से जाने माने डॉक्टर जैन को सिंगापुर के जनरल हॉस्पिटल में इंटरनेशनल लाइव वर्कशॉप के लिए फैकल्टी के रूप में निरंतर आमंत्रित किया जाता है. लिपिग्स यूनिवर्सिटी जर्मनी में लाइव स्कल बेस सर्जरी के लिए डॉक्टर जैन को बुलाया गया था और बुलाया जाता रहता है, और वहां पर उन्हें ऑनररी मास्टर सर्जिकल एक्सपर्ट की मानद उपाधि से सम्मानित भी किया गया है. गेस्ट फैकल्टी के रूप में डॉक्टर जैन इंडोनेशिया, नेपाल, श्रीलंका, टर्की, दुबई और सार्क देशों के भ्रमण कर चुके हैं. देश के, भारत देश के हर प्रांत में, हर बड़े शहर में ईएनटी में आपने अपना हुनर दिखाया है. न्यूरोसर्जन्स को ट्रेनिंग देते हैं. अभी तक लगभग 15 लाइव वर्कशॉप उन्होंने आयोजित की है, 5 कॉन्फ्रेंसेस उन्होंने आयोजित की है, और उनका न्यूरो ऑटोलॉजी डिपार्टमेंट देश के सर्वश्रेष्ठ डिपार्टमेंट में गिना जाता है, जहां पर कॉकलियर, कोबाल्ट और लेजर सर्जरीज नियमित रूप से की जाती हैं. वैज्ञानिक और वैद्यकीय क्षेत्र में काम करते हुए डॉक्टर जैन को अपने सामाजिक ऋण का भी बराबर भान रहता है. आज तक वे लगभग 15,000 फ्री सर्जरीज कर चुके हैं, 5 लाख पेशेंट्स को अपने ट्रीटमेंट से फायदा पहुंचाया है, और जयपुर के भगवान महावीर विकलांग सहायता समिति के अंतर्गत लगभग 5 से 10 हजार हियरिंग एड्स आपने वितरित किए हैं. डॉक्टर सतीश जैन का इतना परिचय देकर मैं डॉक्टर जैन से प्रार्थना करूंगा कि वे अपनी बात को आरंभ करें. डॉक्टर जैन सर.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर फॉर दिस एलाबोरेट इंट्रोडक्शन. थैंक यू. सो गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल माय थैंक्स एंड रिगार्ड्स टू डॉक्टर मारुति फॉर इनवाइटिंग मी टू दिस वर्कशॉप. आई नो एवर सिंस ही प्लान दिस वर्कशॉप ही केप्ट मी कॉलिंग एंड वॉन्टेड टू ऑर्गेनाइज द बेस्ट पॉसिबल वर्कशॉप इन दिस रीजन. He always told me that I want to give my delegate maximum possible. Kindly advise me what do I do and how do I go about. And I am sure that he has done all the arrangements perfect. I remember my last visit to Nanded, and that state conference which Maruti organized was the best ever state conference I ever attended. It was like a national conference, mini national conference. And thank you Maruti for everything. So, to begin with the scientific session which I am given is to start with the radiological anatomy of the paranasal sinuses. This workshop is centered on this endoscopic skull-based surgery, and to understand the endoscopic skull-based surgery, one needs to know in depth details of the anatomy of the paranasal sinuses, the endoscopic anatomy of the paranasal sinuses. We know in last few decades this endoscopic nasal surgery, which started with a basic functional endoscopic sinus surgery by Messer Klinger, has developed, has grown by leaps and bounds, and over the last period of last 4 decades the applications have extended, and every day the new application is added by means of doing by this endoscopic approach. And there are various reasons to it, and the most important is the development in the imaging modalities, more better understanding of the anatomy of the paranasal sinuses, which is basically the corridor to skull base for the endoscopic surgery. So to begin with, we need to know how to go about the radiological aspect, how to know the three-dimensional anatomy of the paranasal sinuses, which is very, very essential to understand. Reason being, the paranasal sinuses are surrounded by the critical structures from all around. The cranial cavity above and the orbits on both sides, and behind are the critical structures like optic nerve, carotid artery, and furthermore structures behind. So this understanding of three-dimensional anatomy of the paranasal sinuses on CT scan, which gives the best details of the anatomy here, is very, very important. As far as CT scan is concerned, for a basic sinus surgery, the coronal CT scan is considered to be sufficient, and it is very important for understanding the surgeon, as it gives the same anatomical understanding what we see through the endoscope. It gives the images in the same plane. So to begin with, I'll take you through how to read the CT scan coronal sections. Then we'll discuss the further details of the paranasal sinuses CT scans. So is it focused over here? Can you focus on this? Hello?
Mic.
Voice jari over. Hello?
Hello, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, hello? Sir.
Is this picture focused?
Yes, sir. It's focused nicely.
Okay. So, we are beginning with reading the coronal CT scans. Okay? Hello?
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
So, this is the first coronal. What is coronal picture? See, if you go back to this one. If you see this picture, if we take the slices in this plane, is the coronal plane. So we begin from anterior to posterior and see how we read the CT scan. So please focus on this one. So this is the first anterior most picture of this coronal cut. Is it focused over there?
Yes, sir, it is focused.
So it is not the understanding the pathology or clarifying the extent of the disease which is more important. The most important thing on CT scan is to understand the anatomy, because this surgery, the endoscopic sinus surgery, the surgery of landmarks. We need to know the three-dimensional anatomy of the paranasal sinuses and then the extent of disease. So if we go through the first slice, what we see here, this is the soft tissue over the frontal bone. These are the nasal bones. This is the cartilaginous nasal septum, and these are the nasal ala. Is it clear? Hello?
Yeah.
Yes, sir, it is clear.
Yeah. Now we move on to the next slide. See, the most important thing in CT scan, or if you order a CT scan to the patient, always ask for thin slice, 1 mm sections, and if available in three dimensions, coronal, axial, and sagittal. Because certain anatomy is best seen on axial sections, or certain things are better seen on, certain information is better given on sagittal section. So if we go on to the next slide, this is probably not 1 mm section, probably 2 mm sections. Reason being, if we have a 1 mm section, we can count each and every cell in the paranasal sinus labyrinth, and we can go by cell to cell, so we can have a full picture in our mind about the relationship of other structure or the structures to each other. In the next section, see now, the frontal bone is coming into the picture. Can you see this?
Yes, sir.
These are the nasal bones, and here is the glimpse of the bony part of the nasal septum. This is the bony part of the, or this is the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid bone, which forms the upper bony part of the septum. Now, moving further behind, we are going behind by 2 millimeters in each sections. Now see, this frontal bone is pneumatized over here. So this is how the frontal sinus is formed. This is the most anterior picture of the frontal sinus. We can see the sinus on this side and some septa which is separating the sinus of the other side. which is not very clear, and once we go behind we'll see everything better. Now below, again the nasal bones, this deviation of the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid, which is giving high deviation to the nasal septum, and you see the anterior nasal spine coming into the picture. Now going further behind, now see the well developed frontal sinuses. This patient has well developed frontal sinuses and there are multiple septa. Generally we see one septum separating the two sinuses, but there could be multiple septa, there could be multiple incomplete septa. These two septa which are seen on the anterior picture may not be there on the posterior picture. So we'll follow this, whether these are complete septa or not. So there are three pneumatized spaces in the frontal bone in this picture. Going down we can see the nasal bone and see this thickening. This is the frontal process of the maxilla coming into the picture. Okay, now going further behind.
Hello.
Yeah,
Satish. Hi, Ashish here.
Hi dear.
So now you better be careful, okay? What you're talking. Satish, good morning. Narayan also here.
Hi Narayan, good morning. Soge the raat ko train mein? Hello?
Yeah, we slept.
Yeah.
We didn't sleep together, but we slept.
Okay. So Ashish, I was taking the audience through the coronal CT images and how to read the coronal CT scan.
Yeah.
Most often we get the patient which is already having a coronal CT scan picture. Though I have already told or suggested, once you order a CT scan to any patient, always order thin slice 0.5 to 1 mm in multi-planar or axial coronal sagittal images.
So earlier that...
Pardon? Hello? Hello?
Hello, Satish, sorry.
Yeah.
Earlier the teaching was 3 millimeter cuts, now you are suggesting 0.5 to 1.
1. See, this paranasal sinus labyrinth consists of many cells. And if we have 1 mm scan, we can count each and every cell, we can follow each and every cell, so that we can have a better understanding of relationship of each and every structure to each other. Okay? Now,
to me, I think when you do the navigation, which you do only for tumors and all, that's when you need 0.5.
No, otherwise also we can get it, we get 0.5 mm sections. CT has to be good. It's not like 2 slice, 4 slice CT scan which can give.
Okay.
It should be either 16 or 64 slices. We can fast cut the 0.5 mm sections.
Okay, go ahead please, sorry.
Okay, moving on to the next picture. Now you see again the well developed frontal sinuses, there are two septa and this is the full picture of the nasal bone, and these are the frontonasal processes. These are the frontonasal processes of maxillary bone. Now this is the upper part of the nasal septum, there is a good significant deviation of the nasal septum, and this is the maxilla coming into the picture. Moving further behind, see this is the frontal bone and this forms the floor of the frontal sinus. Okay, so as long as this floor is intact, we are moving behind, this is the frontal sinuses. Okay, now moving behind, see now again the floor is still intact. Why I am saying this? These frontal sinuses drain through the frontal recess, through the frontal ostium from behind. The ostium is always in the posterior most part, it's not in the anterior part. So as long as this floor is intact, what we see is the frontal sinuses. Okay, now see the inferior turbinates coming into the picture. Hello?
Yes.
Now okay. Moving further behind, now see the picture is changing a little bit, still the floor is intact. See now the previous two septa, what we saw in the earlier images, now there is only one septa here. So what can we infer from this? The septa which was seen in the anterior picture is not posteriorly, that means it was an incomplete septum. So this is the proper intersinus septum. Again there are two incomplete septa posteriorly which were not there in the previous images. Okay, so there are multiple septa, multiple incomplete septa, and one true intersinus septum. Okay?
Yes.
Now, moving further behind, we don't see any other cell in the picture, only the frontal sinuses, and the floor is still intact. Now, moving further behind, again see the well-developed frontal sinuses. See now the glimpse of the maxillary sinus coming into the picture. Can you see this?
Yeah, we can see that.
Yeah, and the inferior turbinate in picture. Now moving behind, but still the floor was intact.
Satish.
Hello?
Satish, if you have a sagittal scan, maybe you can just show the transition from the floor to the frontal recess.
Yeah, Maruti, I went through the images, but we don't have a sagittal picture.
Okay, then you correlate with the first pilot film that you have, the first picture that you showed.
First picture?
First, the pilot film.
Pardon? Where you get cuts?
Pilot.
Cuts. Cut picture, first picture.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can show there what you're trying to show, the transition from the frontal floor to the frontal recess.
Yes. See, you can see here, this is the frontal sinus. Okay? We were going from front to behind. What we saw earlier was this frontal sinus, this wall, then the frontal sinus proper, nasal bones here. Now the rest of the sinuses are behind. We have reached until now here.
Yeah, that's what we wanted to correlate.
So we haven't seen any sinus so far besides the frontal sinus. Okay? Now, moving behind from this picture, you can see again this picture, the last picture we saw, the glimpse of the maxillary sinus coming into the picture. Now, moving to the next picture. Now you see the change in the picture, but still the floor is intact. But now, there are two cells. This is the small one, and this is quite well developed. These cells below the frontal sinus in the anterior cuts, this is frontonasal process. So this cannot be anything else than Agar-Naji cell. Agar-Naji are the most anterior cells. Agar-Naji are basically ethmoidal cells which pneumatize the lacrimal bone. So lacrimal bone is anterior in relation to the frontonasal process, and they lie in the relationship of the frontal recess, anterior relation of the frontal recess. We haven't seen the frontal recess so far. So this should be the Agar-Naji cell. These are almost always present. Now, moving further behind.
Hello, Dr. Satish.
Hello.
Dr. Devri.
Now
here.
The frontal
hello.
Floor has gone. Can you see this?
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Just one question for a picture. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, just a question about prior picture.
Yeah.
Is there any relation between interfrontal septum and perpendicular plate?
Perpendicular plate.
Bony plate. Are they in the same
they are
direction?
Almost always in the same line. You can see here, this is the intersinus septum you are talking about, and this is the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid. This is ethmoidal bone, the part of the ethmoid bone, this is part of the frontal bone.
Yeah.
But they are always in the same plane.
Okay.
And you can see in all the sections, they are always in the same plane.
Yeah.
Now, the next picture, there are more structures coming into the view. These are the two well-developed Agar-Naji cells you can see. And see the glimpse of the middle turbinate coming into the picture on this side. Probably this is also the middle turbinate. And this is the nasolacrimal system. Can you see on both sides?
Yes.
So nasolacrimal system again is very anterior. And in relation to the nasolacrimal system, which is so anterior, these are the Agar-Naji cells. They cannot be anything else than Agar-Naji cells. But now see the floor of the sinuses is almost disappeared. So if you move to the next picture, see, all of a sudden, these spaces looking like the frontal sinus, but there is no floor now. So we have reached the most posterior part, which is continuous inferiorly. So this is proper frontal recess. Okay?
Yes.
This is no more frontal sinus now. This is frontal recess now, which is continuous inferiorly. Now we see the middle turbinate, the first part of the middle turbinate, very clear in this picture. The first part of the middle turbinate is lying in the sagittal plane. The middle turbinate has three parts, and all three parts are lying in a different plane, which contributes to its stability, which is very, very essential. I'll tell you the regions when you go behind further. So this is the first part of the middle turbinate, and see where it is attached to. This is the crista galli. This is the cribriform plate. And this first part of the middle turbinate is attached to the cribriform plate. At the junction of, this is the horizontal plate and this is the lateral plate.
Yes.
Lateral lamella. So these two, the first part of the middle turbinates are attached to the cribriform plate at the junction of horizontal and lateral lamella. And this is the beginning of the frontal recess. And see, if you go back to the previous picture, these are the well-developed Agonigi cells. And just behind the Agonigi, see, the Agonigi is disappearing now. The nasolacrimal duct is in picture. And the frontal recess coming into the picture. So frontal recess is just behind the Agonigi cell. This is very, very important understanding, and we'll see in the live surgical session how Agonigi covers the frontal recess. Frontal recess is not a duct. It's not frontonasal duct. It's a recess, and the final shape of the recess is decided by the surrounding structures. And the most important relation is the Agonigi, which is always anterior to it. So in live surgical session, we'll see, once we remove the Agonigi, the frontal recess will be uncovered. This is the simplest anatomy which we can expect in a patient while surgery. A single Agonigi on both sides, and directly behind the Agonigi are the frontal recess. Once we go behind the Agonigi and fracture it anteriorly, we'll uncover the frontal recess directly. Okay? Hello?
Yes, yes, sir.
Now, moving behind, now see the more structures coming into the view. Now see the maxillary sinuses are looking the full picture of the maxillary sinuses. You can see the uncinate process, you can see arising here and attached to the inferior turbinate. Can you see the uncinate process?
Yes, on
both sides.
Yes.
These are the middle turbinates, both middle turbinates, and see the lamella of the middle turbinate, which is pneumatized on both sides.
Yes.
So this is termed as concha bullosa, pneumatized middle turbinate. Now, another structure. This is the uncinate process, and see now this cell. This is attached to the lamina papyracea here. This well developed cell attached to the lamina papyracea, and this is the bulla ethmoidalis. This is the largest of the anterior ethmoidal cells which we see. So you can see the uncinate bulla ethmoidalis. In between these is the hiatus semilunaris inferioris, and this is a two dimensional cleft, which opens laterally in a three-dimensional space, which is not very clear here. That is infundibulum. I'll show in the other pictures through my presentation how the infundibulum is seen by the other axial and the sagittal sections. So this infundibulum and this anatomy is best seen on axial and sagittal sections. But we can appreciate here the hiatus semilunaris inferioris between the uncinate and the bulla ethmoidalis. And this is frontal recess. Now the difference is, if you are given this kind of a CT scan, this picture only, what will you term this edge? Frontal sinus? This is not frontal sinus now. Frontal sinuses are disappeared. We have left the frontal sinuses anteriorly. But these two pneumatized cells are looking like frontal sinuses.
Yeah.
So how to differentiate? If you go back to the previous picture, can you go back here? See the frontal sinuses. Okay? Now the difference is, as long as the floor is intact, it is frontal sinus. Once the floor is gone, this cannot be frontal sinus. This is a cell behind the frontal sinus now.
Supra-orbital.
And going above the orbit. You can see how it is pneumatizing this orbital process of the frontal bone.
Yes.
Up sometimes up to the zygomatic bone. So this is supraorbital cell,
yes,
which is posterior to frontal sinus. Okay?
Yes.
So once you see this kind of pneumatization in a section which is posterior, if you are given only this single section, then how will you decide that whether it is anterior or posterior section? The presence of maxillary sinus. If you see in the same section developed maxillary sinus and two frontal sinus kind of things, it cannot be frontal sinus. Then if this section is far posterior and it cannot be frontal sinus, it is always supraorbital cell. Is it clear, sir?
Yes.
So now moving further behind, Ashish, sleeping.
Yes, Satish. Yeah,
sleeping.
I'm listening, Baba.
So now going further behind, Ashish, you can interrupt me by your comments anytime.
Only if you make a mistake, please make one.
So now, if you go further behind, You can see the crepiform plate coming into the picture, well developed olfactory fossa, the crista galli, and two olfactory fossa on either side of the crista galli. This is horizontal lamella and this is lateral lamella, very very clear. This is the bulla ethmoidalis. So this is the posterior part of the anterior ethmoid, you can say. We are still in the going through the anterior ethmoid because we can see the roof of the anterior ethmoid over here. Now if you go behind, now see the changes. If you come to this picture, there are more cells coming into the picture, more structures coming into the picture. Again the crepiform plate, same, the bulla ethmoidalis, the uncinate process, and see one more cell here at the level of the infundibulum. This is infraorbital cell. Again this is ethmoidal cell, but the infraorbital ethmoidal cell, this is known as Heller cell. Again the flat Heller, long flat Heller cell on this side. So the importance of this Heller cell is this narrows the outflow of the maxillary sinus. So this contributes to the obstruction if it is present. So one should consider, one should make or prepare his mind while going through the CT scan that he is going to come across the Heller cell. And this cell, once you see through the endoscope, this septa will be closed and sometimes you don't realize and you open a very narrow opening or of the maxillary ostia that can reach, that can stenose. The CT will guide you whether this is the lamina papyracea or the Heller cell, and one should remove this septa between the cell and the maxillary sinus and drain this cell in the maxillary sinus itself, and that's how you widen this outflow of the maxillary sinus. Now so in this picture you can see both sides the Heller cell compromising the outflow of the maxillary sinus. Now going further behind, okay, one more thing, I'll take you back to the previous picture, the uncinate process. Can you come back to this? See, can you see this uncinate process?
Yes.
This uncinate, understanding of the uncinate insertion is very very important to understand the frontal outflow, whether the outflow is draining medially or laterally. The upper insertion of the uncinate is variable. The lower insertion is always same on the inferior turbinate, and if it is going further posteriorly to the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid. But the upper insertion is variable, and this is determined by the development of Agganese cell. See how this uncinate is going. Why I am taking you to this picture? This uncinate is going. Agganese was seen in the previous picture as well, but uncinate was not seen. Uncinate is seen in the picture, the posterior picture. So this forms the posterior medial relationship of the Agganese and then inserts on the lamina papyracea. Sometimes the Agganese is too developed, too big, that pushes the uncinate medially, and then this uncinate inserts either on the middle turbinate or sometimes on the skull base. And this is very very important to understand, because if this uncinate is inserting medially on the turbinate of the skull base, then this frontal outflow will drain in the infundibulum itself. Then there will be a common outflow of the maxillary and the frontal, and very commonly you will see the coexistent frontal and maxillary sinusitis. If this uncinate turns laterally and insert on the lamina papyracea, which is the most common situation, over 90% of the times the uncinate inserts on the lamina papyracea, and in that situation the frontal outflow is medial in the middle meatus. Okay, now we come back to the posterior picture. Now is it focused?
It
Hello?
Is yes.
Yeah, so we were seeing in the last picture the Heller cell. Again we see the Heller cell in picture, and now see there are other important relations as we go posterior. We were in the posterior part of the frontal recess, and what we see, this conical change in the orbit over here. Can you notice this?
Yes, yes.
This is the point where the anterior ethmoidal artery leaves the orbit. Now you see in the next picture very very clear the anterior ethmoidal artery leaving the orbit, and this is the location which must one must pick up, and this is a classical location. If you look into the orbit, see this is the optic now, this is the medial rectus,
yeah,
superior rectus, inferior rectus, lateral rectus, and just above the medial rectus is the superior oblique muscle. See the close relationship of the superior oblique and medial rectus. It is at this site of confluence of the superior oblique and the medial rectus, this entrethmoidal artery leaves the orbit. Is it clear?
Yes.
So it leaves the orbit here and traverses through the roof of the ethmoid and then enters the olfactory fossa by piercing the lateral lamella of the cribriform plate. Can you see this?
Yes.
So how the entrethmoidal artery goes from here? The first compartment is the orbit, then it leaves the orbit, the second compartment is the roof of the ethmoid, and the third compartment is the intracranial part, which it passes through the olfactory fossa. Though I'll show on the other my presentation, this artery, once it enters the olfactory fossa, it runs anteriorly. It runs anteriorly on the olfactory floor of the olfactory fossa, makes a sulcus, the ethmoidal sulcus, and gives off a branch, anterior falcine artery, to the fox cerebri. And then it comes back in the upper part of the nasal cavity, which is the fourth compartment, again extracranial. So intraorbital, extracranial, intracranial, then again extracranial, and supplies the anterior superior part of the nasal cavity. Then from here, after supplying the anterior superior part of the nasal cavity, it again leaves the nasal cavity and come on the outside dorsum of the nose, underneath the nasal bone, and supply the dorsum of the nose. So it traverses various compartments, and this can be picked up on axial scans as well, coronal as well. We'll see on the axial if we have. So now this is the level of, once you see the entrethmoidal artery, this is the level of the basal lamella. Once you go behind in the further CT scans, you'll see the posterior ethmoid coming into the picture. So this is the location of the entrethmoid artery. During live surgery, we'll correlate this with the basal lamella. See now, this is the middle turbinate. Can you see this?
Yes.
Middle turbinate. Now you see in the next picture, the middle turbinate is turning laterally. Can you see this?
Yes, yes.
So this is the level of the ground lamella or basal lamella. Here the middle turbinate, this is the second part of the middle turbinate. The first part, which was lying in the sagittal plane, is now turning laterally and inserting onto the lamina papyracea. So this second part is now lying in the coronal plane. So all these structures which we saw in the ethmoid anterior to the ground lamella were all the parts of
entrethmoid.
This ground lamella demarcates the anterior from the posterior ethmoid, not only anatomically but functionally as well, as all these cells anterior to the ground lamella drain anteriorly in the middle meatus, while the cells behind or the sinuses behind the ground lamella, which we are going to see, all drain behind the basal lamella. So this is an importance from the clinical point of view, as if your patient has a disease limited to the anterior ethmoids, we don't need to clear the posterior ethmoid and the sphenoid if it is perfectly limited to the anterior part of the sinuses, because the posterior group of sinuses have their different drainage. Now in this section we have some more anatomical relationships. If we see in the nasal cavity, this is the inferior turbinate, the middle turbinate which is turning laterally, this defect, can you see this in the medial wall of the maxilla?
Yes.
Is the fontanelle. Since it is behind the uncinate process, this is the posterior fontanelle. Can you see this?
Yes.
And this bone inserting to the orbit, this is the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone inserting to the orbit through the orbital process. This is the orbital process. Okay?
Yes.
Now, moving behind. Now, as I said, once we cross the ground lamella from anterior, we are going from anterior to posterior. After the ground lamella is going to be the posterior ethmoids. Now, see the change. While changing from anterior to posterior ethmoids, there are several changes you will notice on a CT scan. And four or five major changes I will take you through. Number one, the size of the orbit. Size of the orbit. You saw the orbit, the full circumference of the orbit here. Now, as we enter the posterior ethmoid and go behind, can you follow me? Mere saath saath chalna idhar. Chalo. you follow me, the size of the orbit in the posterior sections. Are you following me?
Yes, more square.
See, becoming is more and more smaller. So this is one change. Once you see the posterior ethmoid, the beginning of the posterior ethmoid, you'll see several changes. Number one was the orbit. It is becoming smaller and smaller in size. Second is the change in the maxillary sinus. We saw in the anterior ethmoid, see the globular shape of the maxillary sinus. Now, as we go in the posterior ethmoid and go further behind, follow me. You follow me, please. See this? It is becoming more and more oval.
Oval, yeah.
So this is the posterior part of the maxillary sinus. If you are given a single scan, you can correlate by all these means whether this is a section of the anterior ethmoid or posterior ethmoid or exactly what level you are seeing. Okay? Now the third important change is the skull base. We have seen the cribriform plate with the medial and lateral lamella, and this cribriform we can see is a very thin plate of bone. Now, once we enter the posterior ethmoid, now see the change. Follow me please again. See the flatter roof of the posterior ethmoid. Can you see?
Yes.
Going further behind, flatter and thicker. Can you see?
Yes, yes.
And see more thicker here, and important anatomy, the section is right through the posterior ethmoidal artery. Can you see this? The posterior ethmoidal artery leaving the orbit over here. Most often, you don't see the posterior ethmoidal artery as the roof of the posterior ethmoid is very thick as compared to anterior ethmoid, and this artery traverses through the bone only, and you don't pick up on a CT scan or during live surgery. It's uncommon to see this artery so prominent underneath the skull base. Can you see this posterior ethmoidal artery?
So we can see more clear on right but not on left.
Yes, it's more clear on the right side, but you can see the you can demarcate the ethmoidal artery on the left as well.
Yeah.
Now, so this is another change. Now the next thing is cells. We have seen the smaller number of cells in the anterior ethmoid. Now if we go in the posterior ethmoid, you see the larger cell. Can you see this? Larger and fewer cells. See these large cells, which are less in number, but size is bigger than the anterior ethmoidal cells. So these are posterior ethmoid cells. Okay? So these four or five changes are important to differentiate the anterior from the posterior ethmoids. Okay, so we were here. Now we go to the next picture in the posterior ethmoid. Again, this is the roof of the posterior ethmoid. Now in the nasal cavity, what we see here? The inferior turbinate is here. See the middle turbinate, where it is inserted here?
On the posterior wall of maxilla.
On the medial wall of maxilla, and this is formed by the perpendicular plate of the palatine bone. Okay? And once you see the maxillary, the middle turbinate inserting over here, this is the third part of the middle turbinate now. This is going straight behind, see straight in the axial plane. So this third part of the middle turbinate, which is going behind and it finally inserts on the roof of the coina or ends on the perpendicular plate of the ethmoid, but it lies in a axial plane. We'll correlate the same thing in the live surgical session as well. Now, another important thing, the beginning of the posterior ethmoid is marked by the superior turbinate. Can you see here? Hello?
Yes, left side we can see.
Yeah, you can see the superior turbinate on both sides. Okay. You can see better on this picture, superior turbinate on both sides, yes, forming the medial wall of the posterior ethmoid. So this again is a very, very important anatomy as, and we'll correlate in the live surgical session as well. Why important? This marks the beginning of the posterior ethmoid. So while operating, moment you enter the ground lamella, look medially for the superior turbinate. The moment posterior ethmoid starts, the superior turbinate starts. And this goes all along the entire medial wall of the posterior ethmoid. So this is very, very important. The moment you start the enter the posterior ethmoid, you'll see the middle superior turbinate medially. And this inserts on this thick bone of the posterior ethmoidal roof. Okay?
Yes.
So this is again a difference from the middle turbinate. Middle turbinate inserts on a very thin bone. That's why handling of the middle turbinate has to be very, very, one has to be very, very careful, as any forceful handling or pull on the middle turbinate, can lead to a distant fracture at the level of the cribriform plate. But since this part of the roof of the posterior thymoid is very thick, you can even pull or cut the superior turbinate, and yet you won't see the CSF leak, as the roof of the thymoid is relatively thicker. Okay? Now, yes, at this point, one more important relationship. We are going posteriorly. Now we are going to go behind the maxillary sinus as well. And you see on the posterior lateral aspect of the maxillary sinus, what is this opening leading to the orbit? This is maxillary inferior orbital fissure.
There is.
Okay? Leads to inferior infraorbital nerves and vessels.
Yes.
Okay? Now, moving further posteriorly. Still I am saying it as a posterior thymoid. Why not the sphenoid sinuses? They are still posterior thymoid. The reason being, as long as you see the posterior thymoid, you will see the complete nasal septum. Can you see this?
Yes.
Complete nasal septum. Nasal septum complete. These are large ethmoidal cells. Inferior turbinate, middle turbinate and superior turbinate. The moment you enter the sphenoid, you won't see the
complete septum.
You will see the rostrum of the sphenoid here and the coina below. We'll see this in the next sections. So, as long as we see the complete septum, all these are posterior ethmoidal cells. Okay?
Yes.
All these are posterior ethmoidal cells. Now you see in the next picture. Can you see this picture?
Yes.
Now the septum is gone. See now. Okay, go back to the previous picture. The nasal septum. Can you see this nasal septum?
Complete, yes.
Complete nasal septum.
Yes.
Now see what has changed. You can see the posterior most part of the turbinates.
Yes.
Nasal, there is no more nasal septum. This is intersphenoid septum.
Yes.
And this is the beginning of the coina over here. This is the last part of the nasal septum.
Yes.
And the beginning of the coina. And see this last part of the orbit. Can you see this?
Yes.
This is superior orbital fissure, you can say.
Yes.
Through which lot of nerves and vessels enter the orbit. So this is the last part in superior orbital fissure. This communicates posteriorly to the cavernous sinus. And this is a lot of people consider is as a anterior continuation of the cavernous sinus, because this leads posteriorly to cavernous sinus.
Hmm.
Now, moving further behind, you can see the coina now, very clear.
Yes.
The intersphenoid septum and lots of other structures coming into the picture. Now see, in the lateral wall, this bulge, this protrusion is formed by the carotid artery.
Yes.
Superiorly, these are two depressions or openings, you can see. Hello.
Ah, Satish, yeah.
Yes. Are you getting the picture?
Yeah, we are getting very good picture.
So, we were at the sphenoid, huh?
Yeah.
So, this was the last picture which we were discussing.
Yeah.
The both sphenoid sinuses, intersphenoid septum. Laterally, in the lateral wall, the prominence of carotid artery. Superiorly, this depression belongs to the optic nerve.
Yeah.
And in between this is the clinoid process, anterior clinoid process.
Yeah.
And this is known as the opticocarotid recess. See, in this case, this is not very well pneumatized. Sometimes the sphenoid is over pneumatized and you can see the pneumatization of this recess. In that situation, just behind the recess is the carotid artery. This belongs to basically optic strut. Now,
okay. Sorry, if you don't mind, I'll since we have a little bit time, just point out the carotid, and from the anterior wall of the, you know, we tend to widen the sphenoid ostium.
Yeah.
So the anterior wall. So how far away and how much laterally when one goes, is if at all, is the carotid at risk?
Okay.
Yeah.
See, Ashish, the average depth of the sphenoid sinus is 17 millimeter.
Okay.
It may vary from patient to patient.
Yeah.
But the average depth is 17 millimeter.
Yeah.
And sphenoid lies in the posterior wall. Posteriorly.
Yeah.
And laterally. And now the portion of the sphenoid, the carotid, which is exposed, if we get the exposed carotid, is the cavernous portion, the anterior band of the carotid. See, the carotid, the cavernous carotid has two bands. The carotid, once it comes out of the horizontal petrous carotid, once it comes out of the foramen lacerum, it becomes vertical on either side. Yeah. That is known as paraclival carotid. That is basically cavernous carotid, vertical cavernous carotid. But that is relatively posterior. Okay?
Yeah.
Then it comes anterior and makes a band. That is posterior band of the carotid. Then okay. It comes anterior horizontally. That is the horizontal portion, and then it again turns anteriorly. That is anterior band. So the part of the carotid which we see lateral to the cella is basically the anterior band of the carotid.
Yeah.
And then it further continues as clival segment and then intracranial segment. Mm. So the part of the carotid which is most often, if you get dehiscent, is the anterior band of the cavernous carotid.
So get your mic little bit earlier. Which is your audio was
lateral
good.
To the cella. Are you clear about this?
Yeah, your audio is not so good. It could be better. Earlier it was better. Yeah. Yeah.
Hello.
Yeah. Now okay.
Can you hear me now? Clear?
Yeah. Better.
Okay. So the anterior band of the cavernous carotid is exposed. If it is exposed, that is the portion which is most often exposed, and that is the thinnest part of the or the thinnest the bone over the carotid in the sphenoid sinus. So okay. But that part is lateral to the cella on both sides.
Hello, can you please answer me simple? Yes, anterior can anterior wall of the sphenoid, when you start widening it laterally,
yeah,
is there a risk to the carotid?
No, as long as you stick to the anterior wall.
Anterior
no
wall. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And as I right. told you, the average depth of the sphenoid sinus is 17 millimeter.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Fine.
And
thanks.
See,
thanks.
Most yeah. often carotid is damaged not when it is dehiscent.
Yeah.
It is often damaged when you do some instrumentation
blind.
Or sharp instrumentation within the sphenoid sinus
yeah.
without realizing where you are working. Particularly pulling out the septa or pulling out some lesion or some
working
tumor
in
or whatever.
The sphenoid sinus, not hmm? At the when you are working in the sphenoid sinus.
Yes.
Not when you are widening the sphenoid.
No,
osteo.
Not at all.
Yeah,
not at all.
Yeah, that's
not
what,
at all.
Yeah. Okay. Perfect.
Yeah. So now this is the sphenoid sinus. So now there are lot of pictures, lot of anatomy which is visible in this picture. If you see all these bones, whatever you are seeing in this picture. All belong to the parts of the sphenoid bone.
Yeah.
See, in the previous sections, you saw various bones. There are lots of bones in relation to the nasal cavity and paranasal sinuses. But in this picture, this entire picture, the entire bony anatomy belongs to the sphenoid sinus. There is no other bone. Okay?
Yeah.
See, what is there? This is the body of the sphenoid. Then it has two wings, the lesser wing which is not completely visible. This anterior clinoid is a part of the lesser wing. Then this is the greater wing of sphenoid. Can you see this?
Yeah.
This is greater wing of sphenoid. These are two processes extending inferiorly, pterygoid processes, and from these processes are these two plates, the medial and lateral pterygoid plates. This is the body of the pterygoid process, and see there are two canals which are visible in the body of the pterygoid process in the floor of the sphenoid. The medial one is the Viridian canal
yeah.
and the lateral one is the V2 foramen rotundum. It leads to the maxillary nerve. So once this part of the pterygoid process is not pneumatized, like in this patient, these two canals are seen separately with the non-pneumatized bone in between.
And is coming in the way. Yeah, I think
okay,
okay.
The sorry.
Pointer. Yeah, yeah. Okay,
sure.
Thanks. Yeah.
So you see this part of the pterygoid process is not pneumatized and you can see both the canals.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes this pneumatization of the sphenoid extends into the pterygoid as well. Pterygoid process. Then you see in between these two canals, that is the lateral, that forms the lateral recess of the sphenoid. Like if you remember the Arvind had a case of CSF leak from the lateral recess of the sphenoid.
Correct. Yeah.
In that situation, the best way to deal with that area or to expose that area is to go trans-pterygoid.
Yes.
Drill the pterygoid process and then expose the complete lateral recess and repair the defect. So this is pterygoid process. This is the rostrum of the sphenoid and this is the body of the sphenoid. These two canals. Now,
Satish, go this is a good picture to show how the medial pterygoid plates, they actually form the lateral wall of the corona.
That's a lateral wall of the corona. Yes, yes, Narayan. That's very important. This medial pterygoid plate forms the lateral wall of the posterior most part of the nasal cavity as well as corona. And this has a tremendous significance in skull-based surgery, as now by knowing the anatomy of this region, you can access the parapharyngeal space and the infratemporal fossa endoscopically very easily. Drill the pterygoid, this medial pterygoid plate, you will be right in the infratemporal fossa. In between these two plates is the pterygoid muscle, and just behind is the parapharyngeal space and the eustachian tube. So once we drill this medial pterygoid plate, you come across the eustachian tube and the infratemporal fossa muscle. Cut the eustachian tube, you will be in the parapharyngeal space, exposing the parapharyngeal carotid artery. So Narayan, it was a good point to know that this forms the lateral wall of the corona and the posterior most part of the nasal cavity. Now moving further behind, again you can see the Vidian canal. This is the for V2. Vidian runs in the floor of the sinus at the junction with the this pterygoid process with the body of the sphenoid. This is a very important landmark in skull based surgery, as this Vidian canal leads to the Vidian nerve, which comes from the foramen lacerum behind at the level of the carotid artery. So if you, in the skull based surgery, sometimes if you don't find the carotid artery, just follow the Vidian canal. That will lead posteriorly right up to the foramen lacerum, from where the carotid emerges. So that's a very, very important landmark. Now if you go further behind laterally, though we don't have the further sections, otherwise you will see laterally another canal, the mandibular canal or the foramen ovale, that is far lateral. So all these three branches of the trigeminal nerve diverges after exiting the Michael's cave. The one, the V1 goes superiorly in the superior orbital fissure, superiorly, then V2 comes here, V1 goes superiorly, V2 goes from the foramen rotundum, and from here these two, V2 and median, run anteriorly and open in the pterygopalatine fossa anteriorly, and V3 goes further laterally and then exit the cranial cavity and come in the infratemporal fossa. So that's how this coronal CT scan is read. So this was basic understanding of the coronal CT scan. But
one more small
in
point.
Endoscopic sinus surgery or in the skull based surgery, we need to know the other how to read the other axial and the sagittal section and the significance of those.
Satish, one small point in the last 2-3 cuts which you made, you can probably show them.
Narayan, can you bring your mic closer or speak a bit loudly?
In the last 2-3 cuts, like you spoke about Vidian nerve, you know, being a landmark for the carotid. Can you just elaborate that, and eustachian tube, how it also is a landmark for the carotid?
Carotid?
For the entire carotid.
Yeah. See, Narayan, this Vidian nerve opens in the pterygopalatine fossa anteriorly, and it opens like a funnel shaped opening. Then it runs directly posteriorly in the floor of the sphenoid.
Satish.
Yeah.
I prefer you showing it on the scan so that people understand. I know that anatomy. I just wanted you to show it on the scan. How the bends, you know, the Vidian artery and the, I mean, Vidian nerve and the eustachian tube. Yeah. Just show them how it is related to the carotid, how the segments of the carotid would run.
This on the CT scan?
Yeah, on a CT scan, just roughly.
Yes, you can see on the CT scan, Narayan. I told you, this is the prominence of the carotid artery in the lateral wall of the sphenoid.
Exactly.
You can see that.
Yeah.
And see there in the floor, the Vidian going.
Yeah.
This Vidian, the inclination of Vidian from anterior to posterior is little lateral. As it goes behind, it runs little lateral, and the movement when it comes close to the carotid, it actually crosses the carotid. See where it goes to the carotid, at the level of the foramen lacerum, where the horizontal petrous segment of the carotid becomes the vertical cavernous. So at that horizontal segment becomes vertical, this crosses the band of the carotid. So on CT you can make out this runs in the floor of the sphenoid. I told you, at the junction of this pterygoid process in the floor of the sphenoid, and then runs little laterally, and laterally you can see the carotid artery in the immediate lateral relation of the sphenoid posteriorly. So once it travels posteriorly, it goes directly towards the carotid. Sometimes the sphenoid is not very pneumatized. You're doing some skull based procedure and you really don't know where exactly the carotid is. You need to have a navigation system in that situation. You need to have a Doppler, or otherwise you follow the VDN. This is an excellent landmark to follow the carotid. Naran, you wanted to say something else?
No. You've done a great job. I was just trying to make the point that VDN is the junction of cavernous and petrous part, and the eustachian tube is the junction of the petrous and the parapharyngeal segment. That's what I just wanted to make a point.
Yes. So actually, at the point where when it reaches the foramen lacerum, where this VDN nerve is formed, it actually crosses that band of the carotid artery. It crosses the horizontal segment of the petrous carotid, where it becomes vertical.
Yes, Satish.
The case is induced. Yeah. And I think it will take 10-15 minutes more.
Okay.
For the instruments and everything to be lined up. So do I go through some more CT scans?
Yeah, you can do that.
I will show some variations in the anatomy through my PowerPoint presentation. Can somebody connect the laptop? Narayan?
Yeah.
Are you getting the PowerPoint picture?
Getting a picture, yeah.
Getting?
Yes.
Okay. So I'll go through this presentation quickly until the case starts. So basically, we have seen the coronal CT scans. But we need to have, as I mentioned in the beginning, the axial and sagittal as well in ideal situation. Why? The axial gives some information better than coronal regarding some anatomy like nasopharynx. If you see on this axial, you'll see the details of the nasopharynx better than the axial sections. You can see the eustachian tube. Hello?
Yes, we can hear
you. Yeah, you can see the eustachian tube, orifice, torus, tuberis, and the fossa of Rosenmüller. This is the inferior turbinate. This is the pterygoid process. So all this anatomy is better seen on axial sections. Like similarly, the infratemporal muscles, if there is some tumor extending towards the infratemporal fossa or behind the maxillary sinus or anywhere posterior laterally, this axial gives a better understanding of the relationship of the tumor and the normal structures. Now similarly, the osteomedial complex, as I mentioned, the infundibulum is not very clearly seen on coronal sections, unless you have a 0.5 mm sections. This axial gives a better picture of this entire osteomedial complex area. This is the uncinate process. This is bulla ethmoidalis. This is hiatus seminalis inferioris. This is middle turbinate, and this is where it is leading to the infundibulum. So certain structures are better seen on axial, like this orbit, the entire anteroposterior depth of the orbit, the lamina papyracea in entirety is best seen on axial sections. Similarly, the septal deviation, again the entire anteroposterior length of the septum can be assessed, and the onody cells. You see, what the onody is actually, one of the posterior ethmoidal cell grows beyond the sphenoid sinus laterally, and then this optic nerve comes to line the relationship of the onody rather than the sphenoid. So it can be appreciated well on the axial section. Then the sagittal reconstruction has its significance in certain situations, like knowing the slope of the skull base. You can see the skull base is not a flat horizontal structure. It is sloping, and you need to know before surgery how slope is the skull base is. Otherwise, like if you are introducing your instrument from here, if you don't realize this slope, you can enter accidentally into the cranial cavity. Similarly, the relationship of the sphenoid with the cella is best appreciated on the sagittal reconstruction images, which you can't appreciate on the coronal or axial images. And most importantly, the sagittal reconstruction images gives best information about the frontal recess anatomy. See, there are lots of cells in the frontal recess area, and the relationship of these cells is very, very important to understand to know the frontal recess, actual frontal recess. Like in this picture, you can see this Agar-Naji cell attached anteriorly onto the beak or this process, while this suprabullar cell is attached to the posterior part on the skull base, and in between is the frontal recess. If you know this configuration preoperatively by means of CT scan, you can easily widen the frontal recess by fracturing this Agar-Naji anteriorly and opening the suprabullar recess from anterior and widening them, and you can have a full access. So understanding the frontal recess configuration is very important, and the best information is given by the sagittal picture. Again, the ONOD, you can clearly see this posterior ethmoidal cell is growing above and beyond the sphenoid. How no other picture can give this information better than the sagittal reconstruction images. So once you see the CT scan of a patient where you plan some endoscopic sinus surgery, this is the checklist. You need to see these many things in detail to have a complete three-dimensional understanding of each and every cell and their relationship in this paranasal sinus labyrinth. So this is the checklist, and you need to see each and every structure carefully. Now there are some pictures, some other things which you can see on CT scan, like nasolacrimal system. See all the three sections, the coronal section we have seen in the CT scan as well, the nasolacrimal system you can see on the axial, see at the anteromedial aspect of the maxillary sinus, but the best detail of the nasolacrimal system is given by the sagittal reconstruction images. Your full length of the nasolacrimal duct is seen on sagittal images. So you can make out sometimes if you have any relationship of tumor or something to the nasolacrimal duct, you can make out very well on a sagittal reconstruction. Then the cribriform plate configuration. See, Kiros has defined the depth of the olfactory foci in three types, and this is clinical significance. This is type 1. See how shallow is the olfactory fossa. This is the lateral lamella of the cribriform, which is the thinnest part of the skull base. In type 2, the foci is little deeper than the type 1. It is roughly 4 to 7 millimeter. And see in type 3, how deep is the olfactory fossa. The clinical relevance is, once you are working in the frontal recess area, in this area, to widen the frontal recess, if this olfactory fossa is too deep, if this lateral lamella is too long, there are possibility of injuring this lateral lamella by hitting through some instrument which you are working with. So if this lateral lamella is shallow, you have more space, or you have less area to work for, or less area for instrumentation, so there are less chance of damaging the skull base at this level as compared to a Kiros type 3. And one should realize preoperatively, this is mentioned in the checklist, that's why I put up that slide, the checklist. You have to check each and every anatomy. It's not the pathology that has to be looked in CT scan. It's the anatomy which is more important, so that you don't give any complications unknowingly. Now, this configuration sometime may be different on both sides. This side it is very steep and this side is very shallow. Once you are doing any instrumentation in the frontal recess, you need to know all these things. You can see the level may be different. One side the olfactory fossa is more deeper, one side or shallower. Another thing is CSF leak. If you have a thinner section 0.5 to 1 mm, you can follow the CSF leak and this opacification in continuity with the nasal cavity. This can be picked up with a good CT scan. Skull base, we have discussed, we already discussed that the slope of the skull base has to be seen on sagittal scan. And this is very important, like if you are using a 70 degree telescope, or even with a 0 degree if you are making a opening in the ground lamella, your angle of instrumentation should be important. It should be horizontal rather than being vertical to hit the ground, the skull base. We have seen the anterior ethmoidal skull base, which is relatively thinner than the posterior ethmoidal skull base. We have already discussed all these things. Anterior ethmoidal artery, again we have already discussed. You can see this canal emerging from the orbit to the lateral lamella, the orbitocranial canal. You can see very well on the coronal scan. Then on the axial, if you have a fine axial sections, You see this orbitocranial canal. This is the orbit here. This is the canal. And here it comes into olfactory fossa. And then it runs anteriorly along the crista galli to again come back in the nasal cavity. So you can see on axial pictures very well. Then the posterothmoidal artery, like in the previous CT scan which we saw, you can see a prominent posterothmoidal artery. It's uncommon to see this prominence as the skull base is relatively thicker in this area, and you can see this ethmoidal artery on the posterothmoidal artery on the axial scan as well. Now this picture shows something interesting. We have seen the septal spur can be picked up by means of nasal endoscopy, by means of axial scan, but sagittal scan gives you a better picture of a spur rather than the complete deviation of the septum. Secondly, why I put up this picture is, look at the change in the difference in the configuration of both the maxillary sinuses. See, this sinus is hypoplastic, and what happens in this situation, see the difference in the uncinate process on both sides. This is the uncinate process on this side, and this is the uncinate process on this side. This uncinate, because of this hypoplastic maxillary sinus, is very very close to the orbit. So one has to realize this anatomy preoperatively, as if we use a sickle knife to remove this uncinate process, this lamina being very close to the uncinate can get punctured, or we can have an accidental orbital entry if you don't realize this. So in such situation, it is best to use the reverse biting or a backbiter forceps and remove the uncinate with that forceps rather than using a sickle knife.
Satish,
yeah,
if possible use a pointer on your computer.
Hello?
Use a pointer on the computer.
No, it is connected to the
pointer?
Yeah.
Sorry. Okay, I can skip this. Then the osteometal complex, we have already discussed. You can see all these things contribute to the osteometal complex. The middle turbinate, medially, uncinate process, bulla ethmoidalis, and infundibulum. This is the complete configuration of the osteometal complex, and you can see, we have seen on the axial scan, this can be picked up clearly. Like in this axial scan, the bulla, uncinate, hiatus, and the infundibulum, into which the maxillary sinus opens. See, on this coronal, on a perfectly thin slice coronal scan, you can pick up this entire detail of the osteometal complex on the coronal section as well. Now, in all these three sections, if you correlate the infundibulum, see on the coronal it is here, axial it is here, and see the sagittal. It gives a complete full length demonstration of the information of the this infundibulum. So all three dimensions are important, and endoscopically how this infundibulum looks like, one should not get confused with the maxillary sinus ostium. See, this picture is after uncinectomy. The lower part of the uncinect has been removed, and what you see here, this three-dimensional space is infundibulum. The maxillary sinus ostium is lateral to this. So this ostium actually opens in this three-dimensional space, which is infundibulum. So one should not get confused with the maxillary sinus ostium with the infundibulum. Then some variations of the middle turbinate, like we have already seen in the previous CT scan, the pneumatized middle turbinate, concha bullosa, all this Heller cell, concha bullosa has their significance in compromising the outflow of the maxillary sinus. See, the big concha bullosa obstructing the maxillary sinus outflow. So in any of these situations, if you get concha bullosa, if you get Heller cell like this, you have to treat them accordingly. Like this Heller cell, this is the Heller cell, this is the maxillary sinus. Just simply divide this party wall and communicate this Heller cell with the maxillary sinus. So there are certain ancillary procedures which are to be done with endoscopic sinus surgery to improve the results, like turbinoplasty for the middle turbinate, Heller cell or any other cell, or inferior turbinoplasty if it is obstructing the airway, or if there is septal spur or high deviation. All these things have to be treated simultaneously with the endoscopic sinus surgery procedure. Again, the multiple Heller cell, long flat Heller cell, then like we discussed, the uncinate process, the upper attachment is variable and that dictates the frontal sinus drainage. Like the uncinate here attached to the middle turbinate or the skull base, and the drainage of the frontal sinus in the infundibulum. The common drainage for the frontal and maxillary, which is not seen here if the uncinate is attached to the lamina, then the drainage is in the middle meatus. Then sometimes the uncinate may be pneumatized. It's very, very uncommon. Bulla you can pick up very easily on any CT scan. Sinus lateralis is actually, normally the bulla extends up to the skull base and there is no space above the bulla, as the bulla directly inserts on the skull base. Sometimes the bulla, this is the bulla, sorry, not bulla, the this bulla, this is bulla ethmoidalis, this is not extending up to the skull base, and then there remains the suprabullar space. The only significance of this anatomy is, if the bulla extends up to the skull base, it comes anterior to the interethmoidal artery. It protects the interethmoidal artery. If you do a frontal recess walk while preserving the bulla, you don't damage the interethmoidal artery. In such situation, when the bulla is not extending up to the skull base, then the interethmoidal artery is seen in the suprabullar recess. Then it is exposed in the suprabullar recess, and you have to be careful with your instrumentation so as not to damage the interethmoidal artery. Now, the frontal recess, we have seen the frontal recess, and this anatomy is, this detail is best given by the sagittal reconstruction images. Normally, the drainage of the frontal at the level of the beak is, this opening is hourglass, widened above, widened below, but constriction at the level of the frontal beak, and this is determined by the various cells around. There are groups of cells which are attached to the anterior wall of the frontal sinus to the beak, like the Agar-Naji cell we have seen, and then the frontal cells or the Kuhn cells. Kuhn cells classified them into type 1, 2, 3, 4 according to their extent into the frontal sinus itself. Then there are groups of cells which are attached on the posterior part of the frontal recess, that is skull base. There are suprabullar cells, frontobullar cell or supraorbital cells which offset the frontal sinus outflow by from behind. So if we see one by one, Agar-Naji you can pick up on the most anterior scan, we have seen, we have already discussed, you can skip. Frontal cells which Kuhn has classified into four types, the type 1, this is Agar-Naji, type 1 is one cell above the Agar-Naji but below the level of the beak, it's not extending in the frontal sinus. Then type 2, there are tier of cells, maybe 2, 3, 4, whatever number above the Agar-Naji but still not extending above the beak. The significance of this classification is, this shows the degree of severity in removal of these cells. Type 1 is easiest to remove. In type 2 there are more cells, you have to go more higher up with your instrument and then fracture them anteriorly. In type 3, the one of the cell extends right up in the frontal sinus but not above the 50% of the height of the frontal sinus. So again it obstructs the frontal sinus outflow, and in this situation you really have to have long instrument, you have to have a good 70 degree orientation and long instrument to go right up to behind the cell and fracture it out. So it is more difficult than type 2. And type 4 situation, there may be a lonar cell in the frontal sinus which is far above or more than the 50% of the height of the frontal sinus. One cell may be extending into the frontal sinus about the 50% of the height, or maybe a lonar cell. Either of these is considered as type 4, and this is the most difficult situation. In such situation it is difficult to remove endoscopically without doing something with this frontal beak. If you don't drill this beak out, you can't remove this cell simply. You may have to do sometimes a frontal drill out or draft type 2 or type 3 to remove such large type 4 cells. So this, all these variations in the frontal recess anatomy can be picked up easily by means of a good CT scan. Then there are group of cells which are attached behind, like this. This is the bulla, this is the suprabullar cell, which is extending right into the frontal sinus, up to the frontal sinus. Sometimes it extends right into the frontal sinus, then it is known as frontal bulbar cell. Now, why sagittal reconstruction is important? If you don't realize this cell, if you try to go behind this cell, you will have an accidental intracranial entry. You can't go behind this cell as it is attached behind to the skull base. If you realize, if you know this thing on a pre-op sagittal reconstruction image, you have to open this cell from front and widen the frontal sinus outflow. So that's how the sagittal reconstruction is important. Then the supraorbital cell, we have already discussed in the previous CT scan. These are the cells behind the frontal sinus and they extend above the orbit. So in this situation, you may find, once you see through the endoscope, two openings in the frontal recess going deeper. If you find two openings, it is always the anterior and medial opening, which is the frontal sinus. The posterior and lateral one is the supraorbital. And if it is a big one, you just remove the party wall in between these two and widen the frontal sinus drainage. Then the intersinus septal cell, this is basically pneumatization of the intersinus septum, and this further narrows the frontal sinus outflow. The bigger the cell, the large, more is the blockage, and you can pick up this cell by a pre-op CT scan. This cell drains in either of the frontal sinus. Just simple remove the party wall between the cell and the sinus, like the supraorbital cell, and widen the drainage. Now see the difference. If you have a coronal scan, if you see this kind of a cell in the frontal sinus, this kind of a cell, how can you differentiate whether it is a type 3 cell or a frontal bulla? It's difficult. The only way is, if it is a posterior cell, if it is a posterior section, see this posterior section, you see the maxillary sinus in view. This is far anterior section, you don't see the maxillary sinus in view. So this is the anterior section, means this is a type 3 cell which is attached to the anterior wall. And this is a frontobulbar cell which is attached to the posterior wall of the frontal recess. But this becomes crystal clear if you have a sagittal reconstruction image. If you have a sagittal reconstruction image, see the type 3 cell attached to the anterior wall. You can actually go behind the cell and remove it anteriorly. Why the frontal bulbar cell which is attached to the posterior wall, then you have to open the cell from front. You can't go behind. So this is best depicted on sagittal reconstruction images. Then the interlaminar cell, we can skip this.
Hello, Satish?
Yes, dear.
The patient is ready, man. Hello, induced and ready, I think.
Yes, I have asked them to call me once it is ready. I think it is.
Yeah.
Kitna time lagega?
Ready, Maruti ka phone hai idhar se.
Ready? 5 minutes? 5 minutes, Ashish.
Okay, buddy.
So I'll just quickly go through the remaining. I'll take only important scans. Middle turbinate, you can skip. This is attachment of the first part of the middle turbinate, second part of the middle turbinate in the coronal fashion, the third part of the middle turbinate is going in the axial fashion. We have already discussed variants, paradoxical middle turbinate. See, the middle turbinate is turned outside in, and this blocks, further narrows the frontal sinus outflow. You have to divide the lamella of the middle turbinate in this situation. Pterygopalatine fossa. See, we have seen on the previous coronal scan the pterygopalatine fossa and how it looks like. How it looks like on the coronal scan. This is orbit, and just below the orbit is the pterygopalatine fossa, just posterior superior to the maxillary sinus. See, the best details of the pterygopalatine fossa are given by the axial images. This is pterygopalatine fossa, and this is the crossroad for various structures which pass through this fossa. This is the posteriorly the Vidian canal going to the foramen lacerum here. This is the carotid artery here. So this is the Vidian canal. Laterally, the pterygomaxillary fissure. This inferiorly, you see in this sagittal image, is the greater palatine foramen, greater palatine canal. So it's a crossroad. This is very important to understand this pterygopalatine fossa, as the tumors arising in this pterygopalatine fossa can spread anywhere through all these foramina and canals. Like angiofibroma, if it is in the pterygopalatine fossa, you need to clear carefully the Vidian canal, the pterygomaxillary fissure, the inferior orbital fissure and all, so as not to leave a residual angiofibroma. Like superior turbinate, we have this Onodi cell, though we have not discussed. See, this is the picture of the Onodi cell. This is this on the left side. This is the sphenoid sinus, which is pushed inferomedial, and this is the ethmoidal cell, which is growing above the sphenoid, and this optic nerve is now lying in the lateral wall of the Onodi rather than the lateral wall of the sphenoid. If you don't realize this and go in behind to open the sphenoid without realizing this, you can damage the optic nerve. And on this Onodi cell can be very well picked up by means of a coronal CT scan. See this coronal scan, you see the horizontal septation. This is the septation of the above is the Onodi cell and below is the sphenoid sinus. This is the lateral wall of the anterior wall of the sphenoid, which is pushed below by the Onodi cell, which is seen as the horizontal septa. Sphenoid bone, we have discussed the various relationship of the sphenoid. The greater wing, lesser wing, in between is the superior orbital fissure. Above is the optic canal, the carotid artery. See various structures all around the sphenoid bone. This is the over-pneumatized sphenoid. This is what we were discussing, the lateral recess. This is the Vedian canal and this is V2. And in between, in this pneumatized pterygoid process, is the lateral recess. This is over-pneumatized optico-carotic recess. In this situation, one has to be very careful, as you may find a dehiscent carotid as well as the optic nerve. Then pneumatization may vary in the sphenoid, pre-cellar, cellar, post-cellar pneumatization, exposed optic nerve, carotid artery. See the bulging optic nerve in the sphenoid. If you can know this preoperatively, you can avoid injury to all this. I think the case is ready.